శ్రీ సచ్చిదానంద సద్గురు సాయినాథ్ మహారాజ్ కీ జై. శ్రీ సాయి సచ్చరిత్ర అండ్ ఇన్సైట్ ఎపిసోడ్ 75. మై హంబుల్ ప్రొస్ట్రేషన్స్ అట్ ద లోటస్ ఫీట్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ సద్గురు సాయి. బై ద డివైన్ గ్రేస్ ఆఫ్ సాయి ఎన్ అటెంప్ట్ హ్యాస్ బీన్ మేడ్ టు ట్రాన్స్లేట్ ద జస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద డివైన్ డిస్కోర్స్ ఆఫ్ శ్రీ రామనాథన్ బ్రదర్ telecasted in Sai TV. This is purely done to share the glory of Sai and his divine teachings with more insight to the aspirants. Om Gurur Brahma Gurur Vishnuh Gurur Devo Maheshwarah Gurur Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah. Devotees, we have been diving in the divine ocean, Sri Sai Satcharitra, by heeding to the philosophies of Brahmanyana as imparted by Sadguru Sainath Maharaj to the rich person. Let us listen to few interesting incidents related to this topic portrayed by other religious faiths. Even before the advent of Buddhism or Jainism, the Sanatana Dharma had three streams: Shakti, Shaiva and Vaishnava, forming the Triveni of Hinduism. At one stage, say during the reign of Ashoka, Buddhism tried to dominate Hinduism. Chaos pervaded all through India in the matter of religion and philosophy. There was superstition and bigotry. The number of sects rose and there was constant conflict between them. Such was the state of the country at the time which just preceded the avatara of Shankaracharya. Let's quickly glimpse through a brief history of how Buddhism and Jainism established in India. Vardhamana, son of a Hindu ruler in what is now Bihar, north of the Ganges, sets off home at the young age of 30, leaving his young wife and a daughter. He chose the life of an ascetic following his master and became enlightened after 12 years, which won him a title Mahavira. Mahavira is one of the Kshatriya or warrior caste at a time when the priestly caste has established a rigidly hierarchical society. Power is kept strictly in the priest's hands through their control of the animal sacrifices in the temples. On the other hand, the guiding principles of Jainism reflect a very specific rejection of the temple sacrifices and the Hindu caste system. All royal people were influenced by the speech of the Jain monks as they highlighted the path of peace and salvation that could only be attained by Jainism. Jainism established its roots strongly in Patna or Pataliputra city, one of the famous cities in ancient India. This is also considered as the birthplace of Buddhism, as Gautama Buddha attained enlightenment at the present Bodh Gaya, a town in central Bihar. Mahavira, by the end of his life, had enough disciples to spread his teaching. Jainism eventually became well established in Western India and in the south. The main principle of Jain doctrine is ahimsa, that is non-violence, but it is interpreted as something more extreme. Hence, Jainism became a religion mainly more suitable for merchants and traders than farmers. And as per Jains, the karma is more physical, whereas in Hinduism, each human life is judged in terms of its accumulated karma, and good karma will lead to reincarnation in more fortunate circumstances or in a higher caste. Eventually, it may make possible the ideal, which is moksha, that is, release from this earth and from the cycle of rebirth. It was Adi Shankaracharya who was instrumental in the revival of Hinduism. He became a key figure in restoring belief in the Vedas and Upanishads. He consolidated the doctrine of Advaita Vedanta. He rigorously upheld the integrity of Hindu and social institutions and the Veda, interpreted through the ultimate revelation contained in the Upanishads. His successful philosophical synthesis was a factor in precipitating the final decline of Buddhism in India. In this way, Shankara did much to assure the triumph of Hinduism and its institutions. Buddhism was completely against the Vedic religion and philosophy, denied God and the soul, which posed a great danger to its very survival in its homeland, and forced them to take refuge in other lands. Getting back to the original thread, once Mahavira held a council at Pataliputra during the reign of Bindusara, father of Ashoka. The king noticed people flocking in big numbers and was puzzled, so he called his minister and inquired if there was any annual celebration or religious festival that so many are heading to. The minister immediately said, "Your Highness, the people are going to visit Mahavira as he is stationed in Pataliputra to give discourses." The king was astonished. He said, "I, being the ruler of this kingdom, convene councils to speak about the policies that are formulated for the welfare of the nation or the matters concerned to the people. And the crowd assembled for such councils are very few in number. In fact, to attract more audience, I also give away gifts to all those who attend. Still, I never see a large turnout." Then the minister gave his explanation. "Great one, people are attracted by Mahavira's principles, and moreover, he is an enlightened one. Hence, people are drawn towards him easily." Now the king said, "If that is the case, then even I wish to get enlightened. So go and bring Mahavira here." As per his dictum, the king's messengers went to Mahavira and humbly requested him to accompany to the king's palace, as the king would like to meet him. Mahavira was himself a prince of Ikshvaku dynasty, born to the royal Kshatriya family of King Siddhartha and Queen Trishala of the Lichavi dynasty, who renounced his material wealth, left home when he was 30, lived an ascetic life for 12 years, got enlightened, and has been preaching Jainism. Will such an enlightened and renunciant would heed to the command of this king Bindusara? Never. Instead, he asked the messengers the reason for king's call. They returned to the king and conveyed that Mahavira denied accompanying them but probed the reason for the call. The king said, "Let him know that I wish to get self-realization, so ask him if he would come to the palace to impart the wisdom to me, or should I come to his dwelling to get the upadesh or sermon." Hearing this, Mahavira gave a gentle smile and said, "I am a renunciant. I will not come to the court of your king." The king listened to the response of Mahavira and doubted if the renunciant was not happy with his approach, and decided it is disrespectful to ask a jnani to come to the palace. Instead, he should go to the place where Mahavira was staying. So he went in person, submitted his respects, and beseeched Mahavira thus: "O the great jnani, please bestow self-realization upon me." Mahavira smirked at Bindusara and said, "The seeker of Brahmanyana must possess certain virtues. Moreover, when the seeker is ready, it is granted to him, and it is not something that can be procured at our will." Immediately the king said, "I have brought carts loaded with gifts and other precious items to offer in exchange for the blessing that you would grant upon me." Mahavira stated that enlightenment is not obtained by trading with material objects. The king was puzzled and felt maybe the articles he brought to gift the great saint are not equivalent to the value of Brahmanyana, and he should have brought some more loads of items. Instantly, he signaled his ministers and they got more carts filled with gold and other valuable items in big platters to offer the self-realized. Now Mahavira spoke thus, "King, wealth can never grant you enlightenment. I was once a prince of a wealthy kingdom, renounced all my possessions, led the life of an ascetic for many years and gained enlightenment. So, this highest spiritual level or realization of the supreme truth cannot be gained by providing any of these material wealth that you consider valuable." Whereas, the pronouncements of Mahavira didn't bring any change in the attitude of the king. He was growing more stubborn and felt it would be a great insult if he will not be granted self-realization, as all of these scenes are also being witnessed by his ministers and disciples of Mahavira. Of course, the enlightened one read the thoughts of the king and said that he cannot grant him self-realization, instead directed him to another self-realized soul. The king agreed to this and requested to tell him the whereabouts of the enlightened soul. Mahavira instructed him to approach a janitor's house. Nevertheless, the king was prepared to visit anyone in this connection. So, he went to that person's house and the cleaning worker was shocked at the sudden arrival of the king to his hut. He hurried out of his house and pleaded the king, "Your Highness, how could I serve you? There is no need for you to approach me. If you could have ordered, I would have rushed to the palace." The king narrated all that happened and how Mahavira had instructed him to approach this person for the sake of attaining self-realization. The janitor is a karma yogi, that is, a person who performs his duties devotedly without any complaints. He assumes that work is God and so he dedicates his life for the work entrusted to him, and he also possesses all the attributes of a Brahmanyani, which means he is a self-realized soul. So, it was not difficult for him to comprehend the reason of Mahavira sending the king to him. Now, the worker spoke thus, "Your Majesty, I am ready to grant you Brahmanyana, but prior to that, I need a promise from you." The king asked, "What kind of assurance do you need?" The person said, "Please tell me if you will vow to me that you can retain whatever I grant upon you." The king assured, "Yes, I am confident that I can retain it." Immediately, that person began to list down the qualifications of a Brahmanyani. Astoundingly, this list exactly coincides with the 10 qualifications that were listed by our Sadguru Sainath Maharaj. After heeding to these qualifications, Bindusara understood that wealth is not a means to achieve what he is desiring for. Rather, one must be spiritually evolved, possessing all these attributes to attain self-realization. He submitted his obeisance to the janitor and then returned to the palace. This incident precisely concurs to what happened in Dwarakamayi and how Baba handled the rich person who approached him seeking Brahmanyana. Now let us listen to an incident that is expounded by Saint Matthew, one of the 12 apostles of Lord Jesus Christ. This event is narrated under the chapter God's Kingdom in the Holy Bible. Once, when Lord Jesus Christ was surrounded by his disciples, a rich person approached him and spoke thus, "Oh, the great preacher, I have all prosperities in life, but just lacking self-realization. Hence, I would request you to grant me the pathway to the kingdom of God." Jesus Christ said, "Sure, it will be granted. if you lead your life as per the principles stated in the gospel. The person said, I'm already leading such a life. So please tell me if there are any specific guidelines. Immediately, Jesus Christ said, follow the 10 commandments that were given to Moses and began to list them. Number 1, love and serve the God with all your heart, might, mind and strength. Number 2, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, that is, to not replace the living God with other idols such as money, material possessions, etc. 3, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. 4, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 5, honor thy father and thy mother. 6, thou shalt not kill. 7, thou shalt not commit adultery. 8, thou shalt not steal. 9, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. 10, thou shalt not covet. The impatient rich person quickly said, I am already leading a life as per the 10 commandments. Still I have not attained liberation. Hence, please tell me what more to be done. Jesus, the all-knower, was certain that the rich person is still unripe to obtain the supreme spiritual truth, that is God realization. Hence, he gave a final statement. If that is the case, then dispose all your belongings, distribute the money to the poor and follow me. The moment the person heard this, he was greatly astonished because he has amassed so much of wealth that he cannot even dream of disposing them. So he quietly walked away from there. Now Jesus Christ gave his sermon to the group of disciples. I tell you the truth, it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. This is mentioned in Matthew 19th chapter, verses 16 to 30, and in the revelations of Matthew under chapter 6, 24th verse, it is quoted that, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Here the term masters denote God and money. A similar verse has been sermonized by Sainath Maharaj as poverty is better than kingship, far better than lordship. Thus, we can conclude that all faiths lead to the same destination and articulate the same truth that self-realization cannot be attained by a person who covets for material wealth. Devotees, we are almost at the close of 16th and 17th chapter. There is also a significant feature attached to these chapters. In the other chapters, the Phala Shruti, that is the benefits of reading the chapter, is usually mentioned at the end of the respective chapter. But at the conclusion of chapters 16 and 17, Hemat Panji has listed down the benefits the reader would reap by doing the Parayan of the complete Sri Sai Satcharitra, which means these two chapters claim paramount importance as it talks about the philosophies related to the attainment of the supreme truth, Brahmanyana. These chapters are loaded with philosophies and Sanskrit terms which are new and difficult to comprehend for many. Hence, Hemat Panji assures that the reader can be a scholar or an ignorant one, but the doors of liberation is open to all those who read this chapter, and he will feel great joy reading them. The author further states that even if a person happens to hear a syllable of Sri Sai Satcharitra, his sufferings, problems and sins will be eradicated. Many such affirmations have been quoted by Sri Hemant Panji at various instances which a reader might come across at the time of doing Parayan. But at the end of chapter 16 and 17, he has given a summary of the benefits one would reap by doing a Parayan of these chapters. The author declares that one will enjoy greater benefits in both material and spiritual world by doing a sincere and devoted reading of Sri Sai Satcharitra. Hence, listen to Sri Sai Satcharitra devotedly, contemplate on what is being listened and meditate upon it. By repeating this process, one will have permanent happiness and all his obstacles will be removed. Such is the greatness of this holy epic. Though all these assertions are stated by Hemant Panji in Sri Sai Satcharitra, it is obvious that he is only an instrument in writing this great epic, and it is Sri Sainath Maharaj who is promising all these benefits upon his devotees through these assertions. Therefore, I urge all the listeners to pay their undivided attention to these episodes and read this chapter sincerely and devotedly to reap all the greatest blessings. With this, we conclude chapter 16 and 17 and move towards chapters 18 and 19. The author has titled these chapters as Favors That Was Bestowed on Me, because Hemant Panji elucidates the blessings he was granted by Sri Sainath Maharaj in two parts, and the first part is chapter 18, consisting of 163 OVs, and part 2 becomes chapter 19, comprising of 256 OVs. Chapter 18 and 19 also commences by singing the glory of the great guru Sri Sainath Maharaj, and Hemant Panji beautifully elucidates his state of mind by comparing it with a salt doll that goes to the ocean for a bath. Can ever a salt doll return from the ocean? Never. It dissolves in the ocean and becomes one with it. Similarly, Hemant Panji's soul that has found its source, that is the holy feet of Sadguru Sainath Maharaj, took refuge and got immersed in that supreme bliss from where there is no return. This is termed as Aikya Bhava under self-realization, that is a state of unity or oneness with the God or Guru. Baba revealed the true path to each one according to their capabilities. Hence, let us listen to those experiences sincerely, as it grants greater merits to both the speaker and the listener. There is an erroneous idea among few that divine experiences or dream visions should not be shared with others. If revealed, would lose its vitality. But Hemant Panji clarifies that such opinions are imaginary, and experience bestowed by Guru and God, be of any nature, either imparted personally or through dreams, can be shared word to word with all. There is no reason to hoard the blessings. Every divine experience and vision is a nectar. We have to drink it to our heart's content and partake with everyone. Hemant Panji has supported his views with a beautiful illustration, which we shall listen in the next episode. Bow to Sri Sai. Peace be to all. Om Sai Ram.